This is a breaking news alert from Mid-Michigan Now.
Good afternoon. Thanks for joining us. We are moments away from Governor Gretchen Whitmer taking the podium along with Dr. Janae Caldoun. They're holding another COVID-19 response briefing. Let's go live now to Lansing.
Good afternoon. It is Wednesday, February 17th. Thank you for joining us today. Of course, I've got Dr. Janae Caldoun by my side, Dr. Farhan Bhatti, Kim Trent, Deputy Director of the Prosperity for Michigan Labor and Economic Opportunity Department of LEO, and Mike Larson, the President of the Michigan Association of United Ways. It's been a busy week in Michigan as we press forward on meeting our vaccination goals and working with the legislature to pass the Michigan COVID Recovery Plan and a new budget. Today, in addition to updating you on our continued COVID response and ongoing efforts to pass the Michigan COVID Recovery Plan, in my new fiscal year budget, fiscal year 22 budget, I will be presenting some findings from the Michigan Poverty Task Force that we launched in December of 2019. As the national vaccine rollout continues picking up steam, we are making headway on our goal to equitably vaccinate 70% of Michiganders ages 16 and up. To date, we have administered 1,657,215 vaccines, and that number is growing by the minute. Michigan is ninth nationwide for total vaccines administered, and we are ramping up our efforts to get second shots in arms while prioritizing our frontline workers, educators, veterans, and elderly population. Our goal remains 50,000 shots a day. We have hit that goal on several occasions. Once we get enough vaccines, we will hit it every day. It has now been 22 days since I announced the Michigan COVID Recovery Plan. This provides crucial support for our families, small businesses, and frontline workers. The bill would unleash over $5 billion in federal aid that has already been appropriated in a bill that was signed in December by President Trump. It was supported by Republicans and Democrats in Michigan's congressional delegation. What this bill does is a lot of things to help us re-engage our economy and get people vaccinated and get our kids back in school. Specifically, there is $575 million to expand COVID testing, tracing, and lab capacity in Michigan. There's an additional $90 million to aid vaccination distribution, including funds to set up mobile vaccination units to help put shots in arms of people who are living in rural communities, people who are disabled, vulnerable, or homebound. This also gives us the ability to provide vaccinations for every teacher, this $90 million. Expand rates of vaccinations at every large site. And provide money for vaccine hesitancy messaging and collective scheduling and reporting opportunities. It also, in this bill, provides $225 million to support small businesses and contains key investments to keep Michigan families afloat during unemployment, including unemployment benefits, food programs, and rental assistance. This is crucial support that we need to deploy at the earliest possible moment. Right now, we're leaving that $5 billion just sitting on the table. Other states are deploying these resources. Michigan needs to as well. The recovery plan will help us reach our shared goals, putting people back to work, sending kids to school safely. We can do these things, but we need to have the resources to make sure we're successful at it. I look forward to working with the Republicans in the legislature, the appropriations chairs, and our budget office team, as well as the Democrats, to get this done for our kids and our small business owners and for our families. We got to roll up our sleeves and get to work. In tandem with the Michigan COVID Recovery Plan, the legislature and I also need to come together and find common ground on the fiscal year 2022 budget. Last week, I introduced the budget, my third as the governor of the state, and it is centered on equitably growing our economy by expanding skills training and child care for families, rebuilding the state's crumbling infrastructure, namely our bridges and water infrastructure, and helping small businesses recover from the pandemic. It includes the largest investment in K-12 education in Michigan history, a massive expansion of free or greatly reduced child care opportunities. It funds has funds to fix bridges and water infrastructure that is in critical condition. It raises frontline health care, includes raises for frontline health care workers, and millions in workforce programs to stimulate businesses and help us achieve our 60 by 30 goal. That is 60% of Michigan adults holding a post-secondary certificate or degree by 2030. And it is balanced. Not only is it balanced, but it makes a deposit into our budget stabilization fund of $175 million. I'm proud of this budget. It invests in our people. It funds key projects and unlocks our potential for business and for our workforce. So we have two moving pieces here, the Michigan COVID recovery plan and the 22 budget proposal. We got to get both done. Now, I am grateful that the House and Senate Republicans have put out their two proposals for spending some of the federal dollars available to us, but it's time that we figuratively get in the room and negotiate the details and get it done. Because every day that goes by, that's $5 billion that could be infused into our economy and our efforts to protect people, that those dollars aren't moving. Every day that goes by. Meanwhile, Michigan families are struggling. Michigan businesses need some help. And many are worried about just putting food on the table. These dollars are there for these purposes. Let's deploy them immediately. We know that small businesses are facing uncertainties. Infrastructure continues to crumble, and our schools are stuck in limbo. Let's invest the dollars that have been given to us. Let's invest them in us, in our state, in our schools and health, and in our infrastructure. So I'm once again appealing to the legislature to let's get to the table and negotiate these details and get it done and not waste another precious moment. So now I want to talk to you about a project that's been in the works for over a year. It is the Poverty Task Force. Back in December of 2019, I created the task force to identify new ways that state government can evolve to help low-income Michiganders. Today, against the backdrop of all that has happened over the last year, the task force's mission has taken on a new sense of urgency. The pandemic and resulting recession have exacerbated so many pre-existing challenges. To tackle some of these challenges, we must get a grasp on the state of poverty in Michigan. After I finish up here, you will hear more from the task force's work from Kim Trent, the Deputy Director for Prosperity with the Michigan Labor and Economic Opportunity Department, or LEO as it's known. But I want to take some time to share a few top lines that will animate the way my administration and I will look at the breadth and depth of the economic fallout that we face. Poverty is all too real in Michigan. Too many of our families, too many of our friends, too many of our neighbors have seen their financial security slip away in the past year. To pay for basic necessities like housing and food, transportation, health care, a single adult needs a salary of at least $21,000 a year, and a family of four needs to earn up to $61,000 a year just to fund those basics. Today, 43% of Michiganders earn less than that basic cost of living. And that's why I'm so grateful for the work of the task force led by LEO and comprised of experts from across 14 different state departments. They put forward 35 policy recommendations to alleviate economic hardship and help lift families out of poverty. My administration and I will be taking a close look at these recommendations, and we have included an appropriation in fiscal year 22 budget to conduct additional research on improving the effectiveness of state programs and addressing the barriers that limit people's ability to access them. Today, hundreds of thousands of Michiganders live in poverty, and one out of five children. Lifting them out of poverty will require bold new initiatives, expanded policies, and a significant statewide investment. Together with the Poverty Task Force, who've already done so much incredible work, I look forward to tackling this head on as we continue to build back better from this pandemic and address systemic and systematic issues faced by low-income Michiganders. As this difficult winter will come to a close, and it will eventually, we are approaching spring and summer that could resemble many that we look forward to every year. But I'll reiterate, just as I have for the better part of the last year, our success is always fragile. Right now, we are in a race against variants, that's mutations of COVID-19. What we have done so far has worked. But if we take our eye off the ball now, we risk a fumble late in the game. When we work together, we are capable of uplifting Michigan. For example, today, the Michigan Economic Development Corporation, MEDC, announced Michigan Small Business Survival Grant Program, and they awarded $55 million in grants across dozens of counties statewide. This program was the result of Senate Bill 784, a bipartisan bill I signed to support small businesses, especially those that were impacted by the pandemic. When we work together, we can help people. So even if members of the legislature want to indulge in conspiracy theories or hurl insults, I remain ready. I remain ready to work together to deliver for the people of this state. My judgment will not get clouded by that noise. We're going to stay focused, and we're going to deliver for the people of Michigan. It's time that we do that collectively, though, and that's why I'm continuing to call on the Republican leaders in the legislature to do just that. We have an unprecedented opportunity to invest in Michigan. Inaction at this crucial time is unacceptable. So I encourage members of the legislature to work with me in a civil way to give Michigan families, our businesses, our schools, and communities the resources that they need to survive and to succeed. When this is over, we should all be able to look back and be proud of ourselves and all that we did to face down these once-in-a-lifetime crises. We're so close, and there is good reason for hope. Vaccinations nationwide have picked up speed, and the U.S. is now putting nearly 2 million shots in arms every day. In Michigan, we secured agreements last week from nearly all of our major health insurers to continue waiving out-of-pocket costs for COVID-19 testing, vaccinations, and treatments. Once we pass the Michigan COVID recovery plan and negotiate a comprehensive budget, we can turbocharge our vaccination efforts and come out of the pandemic and economic turndown stronger than ever. It's on all of us to do our part, to remain vigilant, to continue doing all we can to put an end to this pandemic. It means masking up, social distancing, washing your hands, and making a plan to get the vaccine when it's your turn. We have a lot to do, Michigan. Let's do it together, and let's get it done. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Khaldun.
Thank you, Governor. So I continue to be very encouraged by the data we are seeing in the state with regards to COVID-19. Case rates continue to decline and are now at 113 cases per million, down 85% from the mid-November peak. 3.9% of tests in the state are coming back positive, and that continues to decline over the past 5 weeks as well. 5.2% of hospital beds are being used to treat COVID-19 patients, down 79% from our late fall peak. We're also still tracking outbreaks. The overall number of active outbreaks that local health departments are investigating is down 7% from the previous week. These are very encouraging trends that have us moving in the right direction. But as I've mentioned before, over the past several weeks, we will continue to keep a close eye on the number of cases of the B.1.1.7 variant that have been identified. We currently have 157 cases of this variant identified across 12 counties in the state. We continue to move forward with a proactive public health response. This means isolation, quarantine, and frequent testing whenever we identify outbreaks associated with the variant so that we can slow the spread as much as possible. Everyone has a role to play in slowing the spread of this new variant, as there are possibly more cases that we don't yet know about. Wear a well-fitting cloth mask with multiple layers. You can also wear a well-fitting disposable mask, or you can use a cloth mask over a disposable mask to improve its fit. Make sure you are still social distancing, avoiding gatherings with people outside of your household. And please do get tested if you think you may have been exposed to COVID-19, if you are experiencing symptoms, or if you recently traveled outside of the state or to a place where we know variants are circulating. You can also download our exposure notification app called My COVID Alert. This app will notify you if a person near you tests positive, even when that person is someone that you have never met. This is another tool that we have to help slow the spread of this virus. And lastly, when it is your turn to get a vaccine and appointments are available, please do schedule an appointment and get vaccinated. We are quite pleased, as the governor mentioned, about the progress we are making on our vaccinations. More than 1.6 million doses of these safe and effective vaccines have now been administered in Michigan. About 14% of Michiganders have received at least one dose, and over 514,000 people are fully vaccinated, over 500,000 people, meaning they have received both doses of the vaccine. Over 35% of people over the age of 75 in the state have had at least one dose of the vaccine. This means we are well on our way to our goal of vaccinating 70% of Michiganders age 16 and up as quickly as possible. And we're pleased that we continue to see more doses of vaccine be made available to Michigan from the federal government. This is great. As more and more people get vaccinated, we will be able to slow the spread of the virus even more and continue to re-engage our economy, get and keep our kids in school, and get back to some sense of normalcy. We also want to make sure all Michiganders have access to these vaccines. We are working hard to eliminate any barriers to access and protect our most vulnerable. Your ability to get a vaccine should not be impacted by whether you are in a rural or urban part of the state, or lower income, or don't have access to a car, a computer, internet, or you don't speak English. This is what equity means. To drive forward our vaccine equity strategy, Monday, MDHHS announced that 41 of Michigan's federally qualified health centers will begin receiving and administering vaccines to people age 65 and older. These health centers are located in medically underserved areas and provide high-quality, affordable medical services for Michiganders. Additionally, we will be working with providers that have specific plans and partnerships with community-based organizations to remove barriers to access across the state. These providers will be able to request vaccine for programs that can vaccinate people age 60 and up. And starting March 1st, workers in food processing and agricultural settings, and that's about 79,000 Michiganders, will begin to be vaccinated as well. We know these workers in these settings are at higher risk of outbreaks due to COVID-19. So while we're pleased to move forward with this incremental step, we know there are many other people who want to get a vaccine, and there simply are not enough vaccines available for everyone who wants one right now. For everyone who hasn't yet received a vaccine, either because an appointment hasn't been available or you are not yet eligible, we and our local health departments, our hospitals, and other partners thank you for your patience. We will all keep working around the clock until everyone who wants a vaccine is able to get one. So until then, to protect others who are not yet vaccinated, and even after you receive yours, wear your mask, socially distance, and wash your hands. There's hope ahead, but it's critical that we all remain vigilant as we work together to end this pandemic. And with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Boddy.
Good afternoon. My name is Farhan Bhatti. I'm a family physician practicing here in Lansing. I'm also the Michigan State Lead for the Committee to Protect Medicare, a national organization of physicians who are advocating for our patients, and during this pandemic, for enough resources to protect people and save lives. As a physician who cares for patients and families affected by COVID-19, I support the COVID-19 recovery plan because it provides health professionals like me the resources that we need to protect people, reduce sickness, and begin the process of safely returning back to normal. Physicians like me encourage our policymakers to listen to the science, to public health experts, and to medical professionals. Governor Whitmer and her team have offered us a proposal to vaccinate more people, support schools and small businesses, and begin the process of returning to the normal that we all want. Their recommendations are based on science, data, and evidence. I urge our legislators to pass this proposal without delay, without cutting corners, and without thinking that we can fight a deadly, highly contagious pandemic on the cheap. As a physician, I share the frustration of many of my colleagues who feel some politicians are wasting too much time, ignoring too many facts, and frankly, playing political games when patients' lives are at stake. As a physician, I'm concerned that these delays will slow down our efforts to vaccinate as many Michiganders as possible when a more contagious strain of COVID-19 is already spreading. I am concerned that politicians are trying to cut corners when we need an all-hands-on-deck, full-court press to make sure that vaccines get into arms. And we also must reach out to underserved and underrepresented communities, like those I serve every day in my nonprofit clinic, who have suffered the most hospitalizations and deaths during this pandemic. Governor Whitmer's COVID-19 recovery plan means we can vaccinate people, connect with communities of color who are justifiably skeptical of our healthcare system, and begin the hard work of ending health inequities and injustices in healthcare. When you go to a doctor with a life-threatening condition, you would want the best treatment, even if it isn't the cheapest treatment, to get you back to normal. I implore our legislators, don't hold any money back, don't cut corners, and don't play games with people's lives. We simply cannot nickel and dime our way out of a pandemic. Physicians like me want our politicians in Lansing to recognize that the patients we see and care for every day are begging for relief. And we can provide that to them by passing the COVID-19 recovery plan without delay. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'd like to take a moment to thank the members of the Michigan Poverty Task Force and their hardworking staffs for their innovative and intentional work on this very important issue. I believe that creating conditions that give every Michigander access to economic opportunity and prosperity is one of the most sacred duties of government. While many state government efforts are already in place to lift millions of Michiganders out of poverty, the task force is suggesting recommending 35 recommendations organized in five main areas: benefits, economics, criminal justice, health, safety, and housing, and education. Within the report, you will find the detailed specifics. But here are just a few examples of the report's recommendations within each area of concentration. The Benefits Work Group recommends commissioning a comprehensive study on outcomes of former state assistant recipients and adopting a shelter stipend for recipients of temporary assistance to needy families. The Economics Work Group recommends increasing access to Michigan's earned income tax credit, supporting and incubating children's savings account, and expanding the Housing Choice Voucher Pilot Program between the Michigan State Housing Development Authority and the Michigan Department of Corrections. The Criminal Justice Work Group recommends expanding apprenticeship opportunities for inmates while they are incarcerated and diverting people with behavioral health needs away from the justice system. The Health, Safety, and Housing Work Group recommends creating child support pass-through to families who receive or have received cash assistance and funding the Michigan Housing and Community Development Fund. And finally, the Education Work Group recommends expanding the Great Start Readiness Program, expanding early childhood home visits and maternal infant health programs, and increasing income eligibility for child care, and expanding school breakfast and breakfast after the bell programs. Of course, I've just touched the surface here. You will find many more details in the task force comprehensive report. It is my heartfelt belief that these recommendations are the first step toward restoring Michigan's safety net and bringing opportunity to struggling families. I'm happy to say that we have built a strong network of support for this work. And over the coming weeks and months, task force members, staff, and leaders who represent organizations that support this work will have robust conversations with state legislators and other stakeholders about the recommendations in this report. We hope to find a path to consensus to help rebuild Michigan's safety net and build paths to generational economic stability for our state's struggling families. With that, I'd like to turn things over to one of our most strong partners in this work, Mike Larson, President and CEO of the Michigan Association of United Ways.
Thanks, Kim. I would like to thank the members of the Michigan Poverty Task Force for their efforts to identify new ways to help low-income Michiganders build a better life. I would also like to thank Governor Whitmer, who has been a tremendously supportive of the Michigan Association of United Ways ALICE report and to Michigan's most vulnerable. As many of you know, at the United Way, we coined the term ALICE, standing for Assets Limited, Income Constrained, Employed. It's a complex term for a population we know all too well. ALICE is the person who works hard to make a living but still can't seem to make ends meet. ALICE has an income above the federal poverty level but struggles to afford basic household necessities. In the 6 years since the Michigan Association United Way released its first ALICE report, we have started to get a clearer picture of our neighbors, our loved ones, friends than we ever have before. United Ways are at work every day in communities across Michigan to improve conditions for ALICE. We know that low wages, reduced work hours, and depleting savings combined with increased cost of living have made for an uneven economic recovery in Michigan. In looking at real measurable data to identify those who struggle to afford basic needs, we can better visualize ways to collaborate, shine a light, and ultimately reduce the ALICE population. And the Poverty Task Force has set out to do just that. We have the information we need to improve the lives of Michigan residents. Now it's time to do the hard work of improving outcomes for Alice. That work begins with implementing the policies, funding, and priorities that have been outlined by the Poverty Task Force. I commend Governor Whitmer and the Poverty Task Force for their efforts, and I look forward to working together to better serve all Michigan residents. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim and Mike. Appreciate all the work that you and the members of the task force put into it. I know it was an incredibly big undertaking, but so important to our ability to set an agenda that helps lift people out of poverty. So it's wonderful. All right, with that, happy to open it up for a few questions.
Thank you, Governor. We'll take a few questions. We're running a little bit short on time, but we'll turn it over to Emily Lawler with MLive.
Hi, Governor. Wondering if you plan to attend President Biden's tour of the Pfizer facility tomorrow, and also what you're hoping to hear from him on his visit to Michigan.
Yeah, so thanks, Emily, for the question. You know, there aren't a lot of details to share officially from about the president's visit tomorrow, but I'm really glad that he's coming. And as you know, we've got a good relationship, and so I anticipate that as I learn more, we'll be able to share them with you. And I'm looking forward to Michigan hosting him tomorrow. I can say that on behalf of our state, you know, we were one of our proudest moments of the last year was watching those vaccines roll out of Portage, Michigan, and watching the whole national news and globally actually watching what was happening in Portage, Michigan. So the partnership that we have had with the Biden administration is refreshing, and I am just glad that the president is prioritizing vaccine rollouts, the purchase of and dissemination of vaccines, ramping it up every single week since he's taken office, and for the foreseeable future. And so I am grateful for that partnership and glad that he's coming. And when we have more details, we'll share them with you.
We'll turn it over to Rick Albin with Wood TV.
Thank you, Governor, for doing this. We've been hearing about the vaccine rollout being spread out to federally qualified health centers, which means more people in more areas can get the vaccine. Is that reflected in any way of the idea that we're getting more vaccine, or we're just spreading it further?
Well, we are getting more vaccine, and we anticipate to see this trajectory continue. What the Biden administration has told us is that they will give us visibility of 3 weeks of what a minimum will look like. And every week they've upped the numbers that we expect, and so we are able to build out and with a mind toward ensuring that we're increasing access for people. So it is definitely because we're seeing an increase here, and we anticipate that that will continue to be the case. Anything to add, Dr. Jackson? Okay.
Next question will come from Zach Gorchow of Gomer.
Good afternoon, Governor. I'm sure you've seen the criticism and concerns voiced by County Executive Warren Evans and County Executive Mark Hackle regarding vaccine distribution. They both said they are puzzled as to, especially Wayne County, which right now on a per capita basis is seen among the lowest numbers of vaccines in the state. Distributed to it. They're puzzled as to why they are getting fewer vaccines in the Wayne Monroe Washtenaw case, more than 100 fewer vaccines per 100,000 people than other areas of the state. Why is that? What is happening there?
Okay, so I'm going to have Dr. J walk you through what the numbers are so that we can have a conversation based in what the state has actually done here. But what we have seen, I think, is that there just simply are not enough vaccines to meet demand right now. Every state in the nation has that story, and every local municipality is confronting that as well. We're as eager to get more vaccines into Michigan as they are at the county level as well. And that's what we're working toward. and we're seeing increases. In a couple of months, the administration tells us that we'll have more vaccines than we have demand. That'll be a different problem and, frankly, a better problem to have, but it is all dependent on this upward trajectory of vaccines, and they are coming in. And so we are seeing Michigan making great strides and doing so in a way that it has a mind toward equity and getting shots in arms as quickly as possible. With regard to Macomb and Wayne in particular, I'll ask Dr. J to give you a little more insight.
Yeah, so I think it's important to understand how we've been distributing vaccines since December. In the beginning, if you recall, our healthcare workers were the ones that were eligible, so we sent it out to hospitals across the state and local health departments, specifically based on the numbers of healthcare workers that those entities had. So you may have worked at a particular hospital, but you might not actually live in that county where that hospital is located, but that's where you got your vaccine. When we move forward with frontline essential workers and people over the age of 65, we are actually distributing vaccine first and foremost based on how many people for those eligible age groups, so over age 65 and those frontline workers, how many people there are in each jurisdiction across the state. So we have actually seen, including in Wayne County, a steady increase in vaccines that are going to Wayne County, not just for the health department, but for example, Meyer had an allocation of vaccine that they had spread out across the county as well. The biggest challenge we have right now, as the governor has mentioned, is that we don't have enough supply for everyone who wants to get a vaccine right now. And as we continue to see our supply increase, we will be able to include more and more providers across the state.
We have time for a couple more questions. We'll turn it over to Dave Boucher with the Detroit Free.
Hi, Governor. Thank you for the time today. I'm not sure if you've seen it, but the MRLA released a plan that they say that they would like to see implemented regarding how restaurants and eateries can expand indoor dining. It's based off of case positivity rates. I'm wondering if you've had a chance to look at that proposal and what your thoughts are on, you know, adopting something like this for restaurants and businesses and how they're able to reopen moving forward.
So let me start with this. I know that this has been a particularly hard time. I mean, this last 12 months has been hard for everyone, and the burden's been greater for the restaurant industry. There's no question. And so I understand the desire to, raise the voice and to give some input. And we will always take that input and make it a part of the conversation that we're having. We're also going to, though, stay very clear focused on the numbers and the data and monitor where we are. Now, Michigan is in a stronger position than most other states in the nation right now. It's because the pause worked. It's because we're being very thoughtful about incrementally re-engaging sectors of our economy that just inherently pose a higher risk. People want to increase capacity. They want to re-engage. They want to get more people access to vaccines. Then we need to join forces and get the Michigan legislature to pass the Michigan COVID recovery plan. Our success is dependent on having the resources to get people inoculated, to support businesses that have struggled through this time, to make sure that we have the ability to re-engage in-person education in a safe way and be successful at it. The Michigan COVID recovery plan is the linchpin to all of that. And so I will always take input, but what we really need right now is partnership to focus on the pathway out of the pandemic, and that is through this COVID recovery plan.
Hey, Governor, thanks for taking my question. I was wondering if you could expound on what is going on with the negotiations with the Republicans right now on the supplemental? You referenced that you hope that, it sounded like you referenced you hope these negotiations begin. Have they begun? What's happening behind the scenes right now on this money?
I know that the budget director has had some individual conversations with legislators. I know that I've continued to host quadrant meetings in the hopes of getting those to start moving. We are eager to find some common ground here. I know that the Senate put out a plan, the House put out a plan. I put out the COVID recovery plan 22 days ago. Every minute that goes by that we are not deploying those resources threatens our ability to get back to normal. And that's precisely why I'm continuing to call on them to start, let's roll up our sleeves and get this done so that we can get these resources deployed. Our kids in schools and our teachers are counting on us. Our small businesses are counting on us. And certainly the millions of people who want to get that vaccine are counting on us to get this done. And let's get these dollars out there and stop sitting on them.
Thank you, Governor. Thank you, everybody. Stay safe out there.
All right. Thank you.
Governor Gretchen Whitmer and Dr. Jonae Khaldun wrapping up their latest press conference there in Lansing. She once again focused on what she wants to see in Michigan's COVID recovery plan. $575 million to expand testing, contact tracing, and lab capacity. $225 million for small businesses, along with more unemployment, food, and rent help. The governor also saying right now we are in a race against variants, and that what we've done so far has worked, but we must continue. An encouraging note from Dr. Khaldun, who says filled hospital beds in the state down 79% right now from the late fall peak. A lot covered about vaccine supply, distribution, and doses administered. More on those specific numbers on MidMichiganNow.com. We'll also have the latest for you right here on NBC 25 at 5.